Good morning. My name is David Klotz. I'm a member of the Sunday Services Committee and co-coordinator with Ann Fogel for today's service. It is my pleasure to welcome you to UUSC and to give a special welcome to anyone who is visiting with us this morning. We will have a time later in the service when you will have a chance to introduce yourself if you feel comfortable doing so. I have the following announcements. Now, first of all, from Sheila Foran, Just a reminder that the book cart is here this morning for your reading pleasure. You can take a book, leave a book, read a book, talk about books, or spread the word about your favorite new author. So grab a cup of coffee or tea and join us in the lobby after the service. Also, there are still some members who haven't had their photos, pictures taken or provided them for the online photo directory. If anyone here is among that number, you can have yours done after this service. I brought my camera and Joe Madar has his, so we'll be ready to take all the crowds who still need to have it done. I am informed that after that the end of this month, it's done. So if you don't have your photo in, you won't be there. There's a small error in the order of service. Next week's co-coordinators are not Ann and I, or me, Ann and me. They are Jonna DeMilo and Sandy Carosi. And now for the announcement you've all been waiting for.
You know, the 9 o'clock was a little bit louder than that, and there were probably half as many people. So I have some good news and I have some bad news. Do you want good news first or bad news first? Bad news first? There is no coffee after today's service. I know. I had 2 cups after the first service just to make sure that I had enough. So please remember to donate your time so we can all always have coffee, because what do you use need if not coffee? All right, so now bad news taken care of. We will have some dessert. There are some like desserts out there and some sandwiches that were left over, so help yourself to those. But we have nothing else unless somebody wants to do dishes, and I'm not doing them, sorry. All right, now we can ramp it up, sorry. Bring it down, bring it back up. All right, our grand total as of this point this morning, pre-after fair sales, is $12,943.40. I want to say a huge thank you to everyone who donated things, who donated things they created, things from their home, donated their time, donated their money, everything. Thank you so much for making this a success. I do want to shout out a few things. Number one, like I said, our after fair sales will be running today and next week. And then also we are still selling frozen pies. You can find those through the program room and at the window, or come see myself or Jen Clee and we can help you out with that after the service. And also thank you to everyone who paid fair prices for our tag sale room, which doubled their profits from last year. So thank you again, and I hope to see more things and start thinking about next year, because I am right now.
Oh, I invite you now to take a deep breath and relax. Be focused and present. Take another deep breath. Know that you are welcome.
Good morning again. Did you expect to see me twice? All right, so I will be reading our story for all ages today. The title of this book is Those Shoes by Maribeth Boltz and illustrated by Noah Z. Jones. It says, buy these shoes. I have dreams about those shoes, black high tops, 2 white stripes. Grandma, I want them. There's no room for want around here, just need, Grandma says. And what you need are new boots for winter. Brandon T. comes to school in those shoes. He says he's the fastest runner now, not me. I was always the fastest before those shoes came along. Nate comes to school in those shoes. Antonio and I count how many times he goes to the bathroom. 7 times in 1 day. Just so he can walk up and down the hall real slow. Next, Alan Jacoby and Terrence each get a pair. Then one day, in the middle of kickball, one of my shoes comes apart. Looks like you could use a new pair, Jeremy, Mr. Alfrey, the guidance counselor, says. He brings out a box of shoes and other stuff he has for kids who need things. He helps me find the only shoes that are my size. Velcro. Like the ones my little cousin Marshall wears. They have an animal on them from a cartoon I don't think any kid ever watched. When I come back to the classroom, Alan Jacoby takes one look at my Mr. Alfrey shoes and laughs. And so do Terrence, Brandon T., and everyone else. The only kid not laughing is Antonio Parker. At home, Grandma says, "How kind of Mr. Alfrey." I nod and turn my back. I'm not going to cry about some dumb shoes, but when I'm writing my spelling words later, every word looks like the word shoes. And my grip is so tight on my pencil, I think it might burst. On Saturday, Grandma says, "Let's check out those shoes you're wanting so much. I got a bit of money set aside. It might be enough. You never know." At the shoe store, Grandma turns those shoes over so she can check the price. When she sees it, she sits down heavy. "Maybe they wrote it wrong," I say. Grandma shakes her head. Then I remember the thrift shops. What if there's a rich kid who outgrew his or got 2 pairs for Christmas and had to give one of them away? We ride the bus to the first thrift shop. Black cowboy boots, pink slippers, sandals, high heels, every kind of shoes except the ones I want. We ride the bus to the second thrift shop. Not a pair of those shoes in sight. Around the corner is the third thrift shop. I see something in the window. Black shoes with 2 white stripes, high tops, perfect shape, $2.50. Those shoes. My heart is pounding hard as I take off my shoes and hitch up my baggy socks. "How exciting," Grandma says. "What size are they?" I shove my foot into the first shoe, curling my toes to get my heel in. I don't know, but I think they fit. Grandma kneels on the floor and feels for my toes at the end of the shoe. "Oh, Jeremy," she says, "I can't spend good money on shoes that don't fit." I pull the other shoe on and try to walk around. "They're okay," I say, holding my breath and praying that my toes will fall off right then and there. But my toes don't fall off. I buy them anyway with my own money, and I squeeze them on and limp to the bus stop. At home a few days later, Grandma puts a new pair of snow boots in my closet and doesn't say a word about my 2 big feet shuffling around in my 2 small shoes. "Sometimes shoes stretch," I say. Grandma gives me a hug. I check every day, but those shoes don't stretch. I have to wear my Mr. Alfrey's to school instead. One day during math, I glance at Antonio's shoes. One of them is taped up, and his feet look smaller than mine. After school, I head to the park to think. Antonio is there, the only kid who didn't laugh at my Mr. Alfrey shoes. We shoot baskets. A loose piece of tape on Antonio's shoes smacks the concrete every time he jumps. I think, I'm not going to do it. We leap off the swings. I'm not going to do it. We race from one end of the playground to the other. I'm not going to do it, I say. Do what? Antonio says, breathing hard. Grandma calls me in for supper and invites Antonio over too. After supper, he spies my shoes. How come you don't wear them? Antonio asks. I shrug. My hands are sweaty. I could feel him wishing those were his. That night, I'm awake for a long time thinking about Antonio. When morning comes, I try on my shoes one last time. Before I can change my mind, the shoes are in my coat. Snow is beginning to fall as I run across the street to Antonio's apartment. I put the shoes in front of his door, push the doorbell, and run. At school, Antonio is smiling big in his brand new shoes. I feel happy when I look at his face and mad when I look at my Mr. Elfrey shoes. But later, when it's time for recess, something happens. Everywhere there is snow. Leave your shoes in the hall and change into your boots, the teacher announces. Leave your shoes in the hall. It's then that I remember what I have in my backpack. New boots. New black boots that no kid has ever worn before. Standing in line to go to recess, Antonio leans forward and says, "Thanks." I smile and give him a nudge. Let's race. Yes.
Our theme topic for this month is generosity. There are many synonyms for the word generosity, such as kindness, goodness, hospitality, unselfishness, altruism, etc. The most obvious form of generosity is giving money to someone or a worthy cause. The amount of money given may vary for many reasons, ranging from the amount of a person's discretionary fund to how much they value the subject of their generosity. But because this is more of a spiritual discussion, I'd prefer to emphasize the ways all people can be generous, regardless of how much money they have or do not have. In my research, I came upon an article in Interfaith Fullness called Sudoku, The Righteousness of Generosity. Sudoku is the Hebrew word for how the Jewish religion describes the righteousness of the four ways to be generous. To begin with, Jewish religion believes it is an honor for Jews to be generous. While there was not much difference between the non-religious articles that I read and Sudoku, I decided to take my quotes from this article. Quote, "The tradition of Jewish philanthropy is millennia old and miles deep. An ancient tradition held Sudoku or charity was slumbering, and Abraham aroused it. How did he do it? He built an inn with openings in every direction, and he would receive wayfarers. Judaism considers Abraham to be the first human exemplar of generosity. And as an exemplar, he is someone we should follow, unquote. Here are the ways to follow Sadduko. 1, donating money. They stress, quote, we must avoid being grudging in our giving. God loves a cheerful giver, but miserly and resentful people irritate him. 2, helping others, such as voluntarily doing chores for someone, taking food to a homebound person, offering to drive someone to the doctors, etc. Quote, practicing Sadduko reminds us that we are connected to one another and must not be indifferent to the needs of others. 3, sharing wisdom. Quote, this might be life wisdom, advice for their job, advice in dealing with difficult situations, or whatever kind. Unquote. This one can be tricky because sometimes people do not want advice unless they ask for it. So be careful when you think about offering your wise thoughts to someone. This reminds me of some teens who think that their parents are dumb and don't understand their problems. It is not until these teens are in their 20s that their parents suddenly somehow become wiser. Being kind, quote, costs little but makes many rich. Give people your time, your respect, your attention, and therefore their dignity. A person does not need to be poor to need help. They just need to be needy. Practicing Sadduko reminds us that we are connected to one another and must not be indifferent to the needs of others. Unquote. Wouldn't it be interesting if we all decided to be better listeners during our coffee time here? My guess is it would be a very quiet room. In another vein, being generous is not just about giving. It is also about being able to accept someone else's generosity. As Maya Angelou states, I have found that among its other benefits, giving liberates the soul of the giver. Before I end, I would just like to thank all of those who are participating in today's service for giving of their time and talent. And I would like to thank you all for your time and willingness to respectfully listen to this service. And now, ladies and gentlemen, making his first guest appearance here on this podium, please welcome our own Jerry Myers.
Thank you, Ann. Thanks for your wonderful insight and generosity and leading in. I did a little word sleuthing on my own, and I found this definition of generosity in Webster's Pocket Edition, which says that generosity is having or showing willingness to give or share freely. Having or showing willingness to give or share freely. This definition is interesting for two reasons. First, it doesn't say what you should be generous with. When generosity is mentioned, we tend to think of money, but it could include a myriad of things. And I like to think of an oft-used phrase that's attributed to Sir St. Francis of Assisi, where he speaks of time talent, and treasure. Quote, "Time is precious, and once lost, can never be regained. By helping others, you are sharing your personal time for the benefit of mankind." Talent. Talent is given to everyone, not only for personal use, but to enrich the lives of others. Your special talent is the only unique gift that you can give for the benefit of others. Treasure. Your gift of treasure is a direct gift that only you can give. When reading this quote, I thought about us here at UUSE, and what I find interesting is that when we ask for giving here, we just communicate our needs and then rely on the membership to respond to however they feel comfortable. We have no arm twisting, no hard sell tactics, but the results are amazing. I'd like to cite just a few examples of generosity of time, talent, and treasure exhibited here. Imagine the time willingly devoted by the UUSE leadership members on the policy board, then the finance committee, building and grounds committee, personnel committees, followed by the Sunday service, or social justice, membership, religious education committees, just to name a few. In total, our directory lists 20 committees. That's a lot of devoted time and effort. Thank you very much for people. Talent. This is also in abundance here, and we're entertained and inspired by the musical talent, both vocal and instrumental, of our members. And today we thank Laurie and Chris. Laurie and Chris, for your contribution. Another talented group is our communication and technology team, whose efforts produce informational newsletters and a top-notch website. And let's not forget the expertise of our audiovisual team in the back that enhances our Sunday services. Thanks, Dan, for today. And treasure. We finally get to that whispered part of generosity, money. This is another example where you use differ from, quote, mainstream religions. Unlike the TV evangelists, we don't drumbeat for contributions to save ourselves from hell, nor do we sell indulgences to forgive our sins and guarantee a spot in heaven. But however, I have to admit, we run a pretty darn good annual appeal. Thanks to the efforts of our stewardship committee and the generosity of our members, we now have a balanced budget for current and future operations. Earlier, I said there were two interesting aspects of the Webster definition of generosity. The second is that it introduces the concept of sharing. Once again, having or showing willingness to give or share freely. When you share something freely, you do not expect anything in return. So when you have shared, done deal. What's next? But have you noticed that when you share something with someone, somehow that makes you feel better? I have four examples to share with you today about how generosity has made me feel better. First, tutoring. Last year, I volunteered to tutor first grade reading at Verplank Elementary School here in Manchester. Imagine that, an old timer like me with 6 and 7 year olds squirming around. Of course, as parent and grandfather, I read with my children and grandchildren, but they were young, and I had no formal education and teaching. So I didn't know who was going to be nervous, more nervous, them or me. On the first day, the teacher introduced me to the class and then selected one student to sit aside to read for their assigned books. Each subsequent week, I would work in a different student with a different student until I'd read to the entire class, been with the entire class. I soon discovered this group of youngsters was no different than any other I'd been exposed to over the years. Their personalities and skills were varied. Some were shy, some were good readers, some were not. In addition to their varied personalities, I also was wonderful to see that so many cultures had and nationalities were represented in this class. I felt like I was in the United Nations. At the end of the term, the class presented me with a signed card and a small gift, and then in unison said, "Thank you, Mr. Myers." Well, my heart doubled in size and my eyes, I admit, got a little misty. So little did they know that I got far more out of that tutoring experience than I ever expected. And they may soon forget about me, but they'll be in my memory for a long time. P.S. I signed up to do it again this year. 3, Memorial Garden cleanup. A few weeks ago, the Building and Grounds Committee asked for help in sprucing up the Memorial Garden on a Saturday for a ceremony to be held the next day. Now, I love gardening and being outdoors, but since we now live in a condominium, I don't have much of an opportunity to frolic outside. So I showed up with my gardening tools and was assigned the task of trimming the errant growth of vines on the hill and terrace behind our building, right outside this window. Another member was assigned to work with me. I was at Romeo's lunch with this person earlier in the week and did not have a chance to converse with him. Now I would have the opportunity to get him to know better. I've always believed that getting the best way to know people is to be involved with a project together, and that certainly was the case today. By the time we finished, the area looked shipshape, and I felt we could be presentable for the ceremony. I didn't know until the following Sunday, when I discovered that it was for Beth Kirker Stewart. To my surprise, the location that I'd been working on was centered around Beth and Randy's plot. And Randy was one of the first people I met here at UUSE, and we developed a comfortable rapport during the brief treasurer turnover and at Romeo lunches. It made me feel good that I'd played such a small part in making Randy's ceremony for Beth a little nicer. 4, Hartford Marathon. My most recent experience in volunteering was with my Connecticut daughter to work at the Hartford Marathon last month. I'd run some road races before in my youthful era, but never a marathon, and I felt this was an opportunity for me to give back something to workers who had made my races easier. It was not easy getting up at 5 a.m. to go to the check-in, in the dark, in the cold, and in threatening rain. But once we met our crew and received our assignments, along with coffee and donuts, our mood improved and we were eager to get on to our tasks. We were assigned to assist with the police with traffic control at intersections along the route at the 3.1 mile split in West Hartford. For those runners out there, that's a 5K. It is difficult to explain the excitement at the beginning of a race. It is quiet. The crowds are lining the street in anticipation, and finally the lead police car appears with flashing lights. Then the lead motorcycle soon follows, and the wheelchair entrants appear with incredible speed. Next, the lead pack of elite runners appears. Their whispering speed and grace is just amazing. Eventually, the crowd enlarges until the street is filled with runners, each in their own personal quest. The cheering and enthusiasm of the spectators is electrifying, with clapping, shouting, whistling, and cowbells. Finally, the last police cruiser appears, and quiet returns to the course, and the cleanup task begins. Once again, I realized my efforts were minor compared to what I received in return for sharing my time. As a final thought, generosity doesn't have to be a large or magnanimous gesture. In fact, small acts of generosity in everyday life can be the most rewarding. For example, I went to the car wash last week, and as I pulled into the vacuum area, I hoped I wouldn't get next to someone playing loud hip-hop music. I got out of my car to start the vacuum, and sure enough, thump-a-thump-a-thump from the car next to me. A dilemma. Should I complain and be a grump, or just go about my business? I chose the latter, and I'm glad I did, because when I replaced the vacuum hose, my neighbor changed songs with his phone, and I exclaimed, "Nice tune," and it brought a smile from the offender. Then I noticed a small Mexico flag hanging from his rearview mirror and asked him what city he was from. He said, "Ciudad Mexico," and I told him about a vacation I had spent years earlier touring the Yucatan. Then we shared then some observations about Mexico, and when we finished, I wished him a good day, and he waved and said with a smile, "Take care, man." I'm sure he was surprised that an old white guy gringo was actually pleasant to him. At the time, I didn't consider this an act of generosity, but that's what it was, and I felt good the rest of the day. To conclude, whenever an opportunity to be generous presents itself, go ahead, seize the moment, and get ready to feel real good about yourself. And also, give Antonio those shoes. Make it so.
Thank you, Jerry. Thank you. And now we're going to have our closing hymn. We will be singing the first part twice instead of singing the second part. And it is in the teal book on page 1010. The name is We Give Thanks. And please stand if you are able.
It's time now to extinguish our chalice flame. If you have a chalice or candle lit at home, now is the time to extinguish it. The following words are from Reverend Amy Zucker Morgenstern. When we take fire from our chalice, it does not become less, it becomes more. And so we extinguish our chalice, but we take its light and warmth with us, multiplying their power by all of our lives and sharing it with the world. In closing, I'd like to give additional thanks to Laurie Semprebon and Chris Crossgrove and to Mary Bopp for providing the music this morning, to Jerry Myers for telling us what generosity means to him, and to Dan Thompson for providing our tech support. Please join me as we recite the words to our closing circle, which should also be appearing on the screen. Yes, there they are. May faith in the spirit of life and hope for the community of earth and love of the light in each other be ours now and in all the days to come. Thank you.